Now, how many of you have bathed before? Well, if you haven't, I can help with that. So sit back, relax, and enjoy my presentation. What's the process of nutritional labor? And how do we come up with recipes? That's my main inquiry question. And of course, to answer my main inquiry question, we need to have some questions. And that would be a great segue for me to say, what's the process of becoming a baker? The training I have to go through to become a baker is called culinary school. Culinary school is a school where you take multiple courses that are called training, cooking, and baking in all. There are 18 classes for cooking and baking. You can choose to cook or bake in culinary school, but you still have to take one of those classes. For example, if I signed up for baking, I would still have to take all the cooking classes. Now, I'm just going to talk about the baking class because I did a class on baking, but as you see behind me, those are all the cooking classes, so feel free to read them. The first class of the bake shop is called Baking Pastry Techniques. In this class, you learn how to cream, blend, make cakes and cookies, custards and frilly ones and ladyfingers, as well as the lamination method, which is Danish's croissants and puff pastry. The next class we'll have to take is called Equipment and Technology. In this class, you will learn to see, touch, and smell flowers. You will also learn the different types of nuts and apples, as well as so much more. The next class is called Principles of Design. Now, this is more of an art setting class. In this class, you will learn the fundamentals of graphic layout, production of written and visual elements, as well as local fabrication. The next bake shop class is called Individual Production Pastries. In this class, you make everything you find in traditional French pastries. You can make mousse, individual tarts, as well as much more, so you'll be serving these items in the pub. The last bake shop is called Earth Bread and Molds. And this will appeal, touch, as well as use your eyes and smell to bake bread. Next, how are recipes created to accommodate food allergies? Now, how many of you here have allergies? Aren't you always so annoyed they have no recipes that are your allergy free? Starting now, I can help with that. To start off, let's talk about the dairy allergy. Now, if you're one of those people with allergy who loves to bake and has no idea what to replace the milk with, you're in love. I replace the milk with dairy milk, hemp milk, and for the butter, I would do it with vegetable oil, dairy-free margarine spread, or shortening. Now, for those with the egg allergy, you can actually replace the egg with fruits and tinted baking powder like this. 2 tablespoons of baking powder, 1 tablespoon of oil can also be a great substitute for egg. As long as does a soft tofu, as long as you're not allergic to soy, a soft tofu is good. Moving on to the peanut allergy. Now, if you are one of those people with this allergy who, have no idea what to replace the peanuts with, well, if you're only allergic to a specific type of nut like peanuts, you can actually replace it with another nut such as walnuts. But you have to be sure that there's no cross-contamination with enough of the package or processed. Read the labels to be sure. I'm always thinking, what do bakers consider when coming up with recipes? The first thing you need to do when coming up with recipes is doing research. Now, I know when you hear the word doing research, you're like, I already have so much work on my hands, and for the children, I have so much schoolwork on my hands. But if you want to become a professional baker someday, you need to do some research. As Chris Marco says, if you want to make your own recipe, you have to see what's out there first. Now, to start off, you need to dive in and get a sense of proportions. For example, the guy told me to do this, but I'm going to do this much instead. And cooking methods. For example, the recipe told me to knife it like this, but I know you're supposed to knife it this way. As Claire Spies says, use the recipes as roadmaps. Next, you need to write it down. Now for this, you need to type the recipes if it's a magazine. It needs to be perfect. But instead of typing a magazine, you're typing it with reading quantities and precise instructions, but they're practically the same thing. But of course, everything changes when you cook. For example, oh, this doesn't look right, so I'll do it like this instead. Or you don't do it this way. Some people prefer to start cooking and let the recipe take shape. You begin with an idea and add what you want, when you want. But of course, you're not going to stick with the same recipe, not change it up a little, which is why there's a write-it-down part 2, which is a lifesaver. Now for this, you always want to keep a pen and paper. Pencil and cardboard. Oh wait, sorry. Go back to the first one. But you want to keep this in the kitchen with you at all times, just in case you need to write something down that you know you're going to forget and you don't. Next, we're at the fun part. Getting creative. Now, I know you're probably, the recipe is just a guide to help you be on your way. The rest is up to you. Now, I know you're probably all confused about what I just said, but think about it this way. A person sells you a home. You're responsible for getting the furniture in your home, right? Well, same thing as a recipe. The recipe is just giving you what the rest is up to you. Make sense? Okay. Moving on to the next one. Starting slow. Now this means to make changes one at a time. Because if you tweak the flour, the sugar, and the fat all at the same time, it won't turn out good. Next one creates some balance. Now I know what you're thinking. And no, I'm not talking about money. We're gonna talk about that next. But we aren't there yet. But back to my point. I'm talking about making a gooey wedding, for example. The recipe calls for this, but I don't like this, so I'm gonna take it out. And of course we all make mistakes, and you just need to learn to accept those mistakes. And that is a great way for me to say accepting. The more you keep pushing, the more you learn where the boundaries are, says the piece. You won't discover what's too much spice or too much color until you go that far. You have to be comfortable with failure to get good. It's good knowing you will get it right eventually, says Martins. You know, I wonder how much money each chef earns a year. Let's see. Now this is the part where I talk about money. As you see behind me, those are all the different types of chefs and all the different types of money they make a year. As you see, the most amount of money you can make a year is the executive chef, which makes $71,666 a year. And the lowest amount, which is the pantry chef, which makes $4,332 a year. And the average amount of all chefs, which is $38,195 a year. Have you ever wondered what it's like to work in a bakery? Well, I have, so let's check that out. This question really depends on my interview with Scarsdale Bakery. I asked Scarsdale Bakery a series of questions, and he gave me a series of answers. But the one that surprised me the most was, what's the busiest time of year? And he said, Passover, macarons, and Rosh Hashanah for Lots of Holidays. Now this one really surprised me. I thought it was going to say Christmas or New Year's or Hanukkah, but those really surprised me. And even though they're not such long holidays, they're actually two really big holidays. I was still expecting more Christmas. So I guess this is the end, but we need to sum it up somehow. So I guess the process of becoming a baker is going to culinary school and taking all these classes that would be an experience of a life. And also cooking for people with allergies. So that if you